I get asked the question a lot, how reliable are our Bible translations? That question usually comes from someone who is really asking a question about the reliability of the New Testament. And I know that because they formulate the question this way. If the Bible has been translated and retranslated over and over again, how do we know that when we open up a modern English Bible, that we're actually getting the words of Jesus and not something else? And they have in their mind this, if you remember the telephone game from when you were a little kid, you'd sit in a circle and one person would whisper into somebody's ear and then they would take that same message and whisper it into the next ear and into the next, and when it gets back around, everybody kind of laughs at how butchered the message has become. Well, people think translations are like that, that translations have been retranslated and retranslated into the modern day. That's actually not the case. In fact, it's actually the opposite. As we have progressed into the modern era of textual criticism, which is the science of trying to reconstruct the ancient manuscripts of the New Testament, our modern translations have been based on more and even older manuscripts. For example, the King James, which was a fantastic translation in its day, a landmark translation of the Bible into English, was only based on a handful of Greek manuscripts, and those were very late. Not to fault Erasmus or the King James translators who put that together. They were using the Greek manuscripts that we had. God bless them. Modern translations of the Bible are going back even further into the history of the text because we now have available to us even older manuscripts. Where Erasmus only had medieval manuscripts available to him, we have manuscripts that go all the way back to the 2nd century. We have fragments that go back to the early part of the 2nd century. And all of those have been taken into account when new translations are made. The King James is not the foundation for any modern translation. Ancient Greek manuscripts are. With modern English translations, you are getting a more reliable translation based on more data, based on more scientific discovery, based on more available manuscripts, which are older and which are considered by most experts to be even more reliable than the medieval manuscripts used by Erasmus. Now, most modern translations use that same Greek text, that Greek text that's been produced by scholars from the most ancient of sources. But the question still remains, how do I know which translation I ought to buy? How do I know which one I ought to use? Well, that's not an easy question, and it's not an easy question because translations are like tools. They're not all produced for the same purpose. Some are hammers, and some are screwdrivers, and if you need a hammer, a screwdriver's not going to do the job. When you think in terms of translation philosophy, you've got a continuum. On one side of the continuum, you've got what's called the formal equivalence approach. They're striving for pure accuracy, to get as close to one English word for one Greek word as possible. And they've produced some excellent scholarly translations, translations like the New American Standard Bible or the Old RSV. The problem with that approach, with the formal equivalence approach, is that it produces a translation that's a little bit hard to read. It's a little stilted, a little wooden. It's not great for reading in public. It's a great translation, but it's not perfect for church use necessarily. At the other end of the continuum is the paraphrase. And unlike the formal equivalent, where you have a Greek word, English word, Greek word, English word, the paraphrase attempts to capture the thought. We read the words of Paul in Greek and we ask the question, what's the best way to translate this into English? There's not always a correspondence to words or sometimes even sentences. It's thought for thought. And paraphrases are great. They make great children's Bibles. They make great Bibles for reading. If you want to read through the Bible, whole passages of the Bible at one time, they're great. Probably not going to be great for study. In the middle of that continuum, we have what we call the dynamic equivalence. And that's trying to strike a balance between the two extremes. Probably the most popular translation of all falls into that category, and that's the NIV. It is word for word in the sense that they try to capture Greek word, English word, Greek word, English word, but they also try to employ idiom, where we have a phrase in Greek that's idiomatic. We try to capture that as an idiom in English. Not as precise as the formal equivalent, not as loose as the paraphrase, but it does strike a happy median between hard to read and easy to read. That's probably why it's more popular. On the formal equivalent side of things, that's probably where I'm the most comfortable. Most scholars, most students of the Bible, most New Testament professors are probably going to be most comfortable on this side of the continuum, on the formal equivalent side. And as I've said, there are some great translations over there. The New American Standard Bible is a very robust academic translation that has served the scholarly community well. The New King James is a revision of the King James. It's a great translation. It's a robust translation that attempts to capture some of the beauty of the English language in the King James. The ESV is a fairly new translation. It's very popular, and it's popular because it is a robust translation. It is formally equivalent, but it's also easy to read, and it's designed with the reader in mind. So what does this all mean? Well, it means this. Read your Bible. The Bible that you have in front of you, if you have one of these translations that we've talked about, really is a good translation. It's a very accurate representation in English of the words of Jesus, the words of Paul, the words of the prophets, the Word of God. And you don't need to fear that maybe you're getting some kind of convoluted message because of translation history. It's not the case at all. We now know more about what the ancient manuscripts said. We have older manuscripts available to us, and we have some of the finest translation techniques ever available. And those were all employed in the production of the Bible you have in front of you. So read it.